Yesterday, we were discussing about this pile design. There are various aspects of the design. The important thing is the design that is to be done during the stage of construction. Normally, that design is not done. There is some construction practice which is being followed. In certain cases, the design is also carried out. So, this is a reinforcement bar which is transported by a barge. What is the length of the bar reinforcement that is available in the market? 12 meters. So, if you are handling a 12 meter long bar, it has some weight. It may vary from 3 tons to 6 tons depending on the reinforcement. You are seeing some inner rings here, maybe in another figure it will be seen. This is to keep the bar in position. This is the inner ring, there is outer ring. Outer ring is a shear reinforcement, inner ring is to keep the shape correctly. If you want a circular shape, that means you have to provide a template. There is an inner ring which is provided. Typically it is about 16 mm or 20 mm diameter bars at every 1 to 1.5 meters center to center. This is to keep the bar in position, that is the main reinforcement, as well as to keep the shape all right also. So, there is a person who is holding the bar and is lowering it. For lowering these bars also, we need to provide some hooks and other things that is not shown in this, that also is a part of the temporary design. Here you can see the larger diameter bar, this is your inner bar, and these are smaller diameter bars which are outside. These are the main reinforcement bars. Once you are lowering the bars inside the this liner, the gap between them should be more than, clear gap should be more than 100 millimeters, otherwise the concrete will not flow. For land based structure it is different, it may be around 40 millimeter or more than the diameter of the bar, something like that. Whereas in pile construction we need a clear gap of 100 millimeter. This comes in construction practice. So, here you can see the inner bar clearly, this is the inner bar, this is the outer bars, and we have to provide a lap. Lap means when this reinforcement bar is ending and you are putting another reinforcement bar, we have to calculate what is known as development length. So, that also is to be calculated. Development length depends on what? Many civil engineers are here. Diameter of the bar, then what else?
Bond strength
depends on what?
Grade
of concrete. Then what else?
Deformity of
steel. Don't think too much. What else?
Sir, plain steel and that.
Deformity is different. You said deformity.
Surface.
Good. Deformity you said. I went for some other thing. It is a deformed bars. Maybe T and D is confused. That is the correct answer, plain or deformed bars. What will be the reduction in lap length if it is a deformed bar compared to a plain bar? Please check, I think it is about 25% or 40%, I do not remember. Then what else? The bars, whether they are in tension or compression, that is very important, that the bars are in tension or compression, that also. Then another important aspect is you cannot lap the bar at the same level, okay. That is another important thing. This is what is known as detailing. Most of the structures which are failing, they fail either during the construction stage, and mainly the failure, if at all, takes place after construction or during construction. The problem is because of poor detailing, not because of poor design. And another thing is a construction methodology or practice which is not done properly. So, you have to give if you are lapping one bar from this point onwards, the other bar should be lapped with a clear gap of around 300 millimeters. So, you have to provide sufficient length of the reinforcement bars for lapping. What is the typical development length? It relates to what? Development length relates to what? I want to say this much development length is to be provided. How much you will provide? Approximately. Question is not clear. You provide 1 meter, 2 meter, or in relation to some other dimension you will provide? How much you will provide?
Diameter.
Don't go to the bar bender and tell it depends on deformed. That is a plain bar, deformed bar, grade of concrete, he will not understand. If you are going to the site, you should tell him clearly how much lap length is to be provided. How will you tell him? Either English or Hindi or whatever it is. You will tell in terms of meters, but there any other method to tell? You tell in terms of diameter of bar.
In terms of diameter.
You told earlier. Did you tell earlier? I didn't hear you. How much diameter? 40 times the diameter of the bar. It varies from 36 times diameter of the bar to about 60 times diameter of the bar. One of the important thing which you didn't tell is about the strength of steel. Okay, whether it is a mild steel or 415 grade or 500 grade, that also depends. These are the various aspects that is to be considered. So I said we provide 100 millimeter clear gap. In case you are not able to provide 100 millimeter clear gap, you can bundle the bars. That means you can keep two bars side by side. Then when they are concreting, there will be some lean concrete which you have to chip off and you have to throw it out. That is another aspect which you have to do. So here what is shown is, I do not know whether you are able to see this clearly. This is the inner core of the pile and this is the main bars. This may be a lap bar or it is a bundled bar. What you are seeing is a pile cap which is coming and sitting on the cover of the pile reinforcement. What you are seeing here is a pedestal and these are the hooks which are provided to lift the pile cap. So this is the type of construction which they do generally to speed up the construction. So the another important aspect is we do certain aspects to increase the speed of construction. So if this is the pile what is provided, we have to know what is known as tolerance. What is tolerance? What is tolerance?
Allowance.
What is that allowance? What will happen when you are driving a pile? What kind of tolerance is required? Suppose you are driving a pile, what kind of problem you may encounter? See, suppose this is a pile, when you are driving it, this may not go vertically down, this may go in an inclined manner. Suppose the pile is to be located here, it may be located at a different point. It is not possible exactly you can put it. There is a tolerance limit which is given. I do not remember exactly. Generally it is not more than 75 millimeter at the top. When you go to the site and if that fellow is not able to get exactly the location, do not blame that fellow. It is humanly impossible. If it is within plus or minus 75 mm, you have to adjust. Then you have to adjust the other things also. So that is why we provide what is known as a pile cap. What is this pile cap? The pile cap is a precast construction so that the construction can become very fast. There is a slot, circular slot, what you are seeing there, only edges are there. This is what we make. This pile cap, this minimum dimension should be 150 millimeters from the face of the pile. So this will adjust that 75 millimeters. Okay, 150 mm more. Suppose the pile is 1200 millimeters, the pile cap what you are making will be like this. This is the pile which is coming here and this dimension will be 1500 by 1500, and this pile cap is made to rest on the cover portion of the pile. So this is your 1200. Generally the cover is 75, that means this will be 1200 minus 150, that is 1050. So what is happening is the pile cap is resting over a bearing of 75 millimeters. Suppose this is a beam or whatever it is, you want to place it. How will you place it? You can place like this also, very easy, but you will place like this also. You cannot place like this, it will fall down. There is some bearing required. For that bearing, there is a calculation, bearing pressure you have to calculate. That bearing generally is about 75 to 100 millimeters, okay. Then this beams, what is coming, there will be one beam coming here and resting like this. There will be another beam coming and resting like this. These are the two beams which are placed. What, these two beams may be deeper compared to the beams in the other side, because top of the deck should be the same, deck slab shaft should remain the same, but the beams may be different. So for that, what they do is they provide some pedestal here. So that you can place the beam on top of it, that is what you are seeing, and there are some hooks provided. Maybe you may provide a hook here, here, and then lift it. The hook also should go into the concrete. That is what is shown here for a particular project. Now you can see this is the pedestal, this is the inner core. The pile cap is coming here and resting adjacent to the reinforcement, maybe 75 mm bearing is there. The beam this side will rest on the top of the pile cap, and this side it will rest on top of the pedestal. And this is the hook which is used to lift the pile cap. This hook goes inside the pile cap. When they are going to place the precast beam, they will cut this reinforcement.
So what is it, bundle?
Bundle means two bars together they will keep it. Suppose you want to provide 60 bars in a 1200 dia pile. The spacing is 60. If you calculate the spacing, it will not be less than, it will not be more than 100 millimeter clear gap. Then you put two bars together, bundle. That means you put only 30 bundled bars, each bundle containing two bars. You can have 20 bundles of three bars in each bundle, that also you can do. So in order to avoid all these things, we prefer to have the reinforcement about between 1 to 2%. Earlier we were discussing about 2%, nowadays we want to give only 1%. For that you have to increase the diameter. There will be some congestion of reinforcement, and here it is some in situ pile cap is being made. Instead of doing a precast pile cap, here they are doing the in situ pile cap. So this is the pile reinforcement bars, the beam bars at the bottom will come. So this is the type of congestion that is there in a pile beam junction. This also you have to think carefully and do it. This is about the pile. The next is about the beam design. There are two types of bending moment, one is called as a hogging bending moment, another is called as a sagging bending moment. What is hogging bending moment, what is sagging bending moment?
Sagging is positive moment, compression
is
positive.
Tension. Compression on the top and tension on the bottom. Yeah, that is a way to answer. So you take a compression at the top and tension at the bottom, that is called as a sagging moment. Hogging means other way, you can say about convex and concave also. Concave deflection is sagging and convex is hogging. So the depending on the loads coming on the structure, you can have a hogging moment, that means the negative moment. This bending moment diagram is drawn on the tension side. If you are what is that fellow doing behind you? No. There are two ways of drawing the bending moment diagram. You can draw the bending moment diagram on the tension side, or you can draw the bending moment diagram on the compression side. Even some foreign books, they draw the bending moment diagram on the compression side, okay. Generally people draw the bending moment diagram on the tension side. That means if you have a bending moment like this, it means you have to provide tension at the top or this side, reinforcement at this side. And here you have to provide the reinforcement. Then there is a curtailment, the bending moment here is 0. So whatever bending moment you are providing here need not have to go continuously. Suppose this is a support, generally this is the pile supports. So you don't have to provide whatever reinforcement you are providing into the pile junction. But there is a rider that you have to provide 50% of the reinforcement into the bottom reinforcement. You cannot curtail it suddenly. You can curtail 1/3 of a reinforcement at a particular time. But general recommendation is you don't reduce the reinforcement less than 50% in the supports, right? Positive moment especially. This shows the sagging moment. The bending moment is maximum here. It depends on the load condition where you are placing the load. And this shows the bending moment envelope, what you are trying to get. Considering all the load combination, what will be the maximum bending moment? If you are able to get this bending moment envelope properly, then you can provide the reinforcement accordingly. Similarly, you can get the shear force also. You have to design for both pile, beam and slab for axial force, bending moment and shear force. We have to finalize these parameters. There are different grades of concrete. M35 is the grade of concrete. What is the minimum grade of concrete to be used for reinforced concrete structures? M20, 15 is not there, 20 is there. For marine structures, you have to use minimum of M30 grade. How much maximum you can get concrete strength? 200 is not possible. Yeah. Who told 200?
Get to
I will talk to get to. 200 is it? 200. I will talk to him. Maybe it may be some special type of concrete. Generally, for common purpose, they use up to M80. But for getting higher grade of concrete, it is not super plasticizer that is required. What is required to get higher grade of concrete?
Replace the coating grade with iron.
Fibers.
There is another better method. You don't know about silica fume? Yeah, you have to add silica fume. About 5% silica fume if you add, your strength will increase. Generally, if you want to increase the strength, you have cement, sand, coarse aggregate, water. What is to be done to increase the strength of concrete? Only one answer you have to tell. Don't tell all answers in the world.
Cement, water cement.
Water cement, that is the correct answer. What is to be done with water cement ratio? Huh? Decrease. What, how much it can be decreased? Decrease. Lowest value I am asking.
0.35
you can use. Generally up to 0.55 you can do. But for marine structures, you should not use anything more than 0.45. Why? You can get two water cement ratios. One is 0.35, another is 0.5. Same strength you can get. I am saying 0.35 is preferred. Why? Strength is the same. 0.35 and 0.5 is the water cement ratio. Strength is the same, but I am saying you use 0.35 instead of 0.5. What is the reason?
Segregation. More segregation.
Segregation is construction problem.
Hydration
is chemistry problem. You do curing properly. You avoid segregation, do curing, everything you do it properly, but still I would like to have 0.35 ratio compared to 0.5 ratio.
Why?
Durability is the right answer. Permeability, because of lesser permeability, you have higher durability. So what you have to talk about concrete structure is strength and durability. Lower water cement ratio ensures better durability. Okay. Another thing is the cover. So then second level of answer we will see. To increase the durability, you have to reduce the water cement ratio. Then what else you can do?
Use silica
fumes. Silica fumes to increase the strength.
So it will block the pores also.
It will block, but the silica fume is expensive.
Marine structures are there.
See, you are going in a Mercedes Benz, go in a highway. For all kinds of road, don't go for Mercedes Benz. silica frame you use it for higher grade of concrete, no questions. But increasing durability across all grades of concrete, silica frame is not the answer. You understood? Increasing durability for a M35 or M40 grade of concrete, silica frame is not the answer. Fly ash increases why it increases? It's finer than cement. So yeah, finer than cement. It fills up the voids of cement, so it increases. How much of a fly ash can be added? See, you have generally 8 to 9 bags of cement. I'm sorry. Yeah, 8 to 9 bags of cements that is used per cubic meter of concrete. What is the weight of 1 cubic meter of concrete? 2,400 kg. 8 bags of cement. What is the weight? 8 bags of cement. What is the weight? 8 bags. What is the weight? 400 kg. So in 2,400 kg, you are putting 400 kg of cement. Instead of putting 400 kg of cement, you can put 300 kg of cement and 100 kg of fly ash. So it reduces the cost. Other than fly ash, what else can be used? Not gypsum. We don't know. Fly ash, pozzolanic material only. What is it? Slag. Blast furnace slag cement can be used. That is much better than fly ash. But actually, if you use a slag cement, you can put 300 kg of slag and 100 kg of cement. Do you know that? It's being done. Ennore port is built like that. 300 kg of slag and 100 kg of cement. Ulta. It gives better performance also. Then grade of steel 415 and 500 you can use. What is the maximum diameter of bar available? I think 36 also available. Then you provide clear cover 50. The depth of the beam is 1500, width is 1200. Generally the width of the beam in harbor constructions are much wider compared to any other thing. Increasing the depth is better for design, but increasing the width is better for construction. We have come across some designs by Australian company for one of the port on Jawaharlal Nehru. His width is more than the depth. I was thinking why this he has done like that. It is only for reducing the congestion at the junction. He has provided more width than the depth. Structural designers prefer to have more depth because they say there is cost saving. Actually, increasing the width is better. We prefer to go for a beam width which is generally more than the diameter of the pile. I have given 1200 mm is the diameter of the pile. I would prefer to go 1500 mm for the width of the beam so that you can provide the reinforcement at the sites. It may look uneconomical, it is not always uneconomical. Then you have to calculate the effective depth. This only come into the design equations. So this is the definition, this is the overall depth. From the central line of the main reinforcement to the extreme face is effective cover, and from the top surface to the central line of the reinforcement is called as the effective depth. The construction is done for marine structures using a composite construction consisting of precast and cast in situ beam. Why are you doing this precasting and cast in situ like this box section? Why are we concreting only a smaller area for precast? The other alternatives, you can concrete 50% of the beam precast, 50% as in situ. See, there are two methods by which you can do the precast and composite construction. One is you have only the skin for the other method is you cast suppose this is 1500. So the whole thing can be precast like this. Here we are precasting only this much portion. Why do we do a smaller portion instead of doing a full? What is the reason? Generally this is preferred. Why we do like this? Mainly to reduce the weight of handling. When you want to handle the precast section, if you do the total or 90% or 60% of the beam as precast, the weight will be very high. Generally they will be able to handle about 6 to 8 tons weight only. So to reduce the weight we are putting, I am giving a temporary strut, otherwise it is a lift. These are the hooks which are provided to lift. This location of the hooks also is important. There is a classical problem in structural engineering where to locate these hooks. These hooks are located at the ends, but generally it is located at a distance of 0.216 times length to get the hogging and bending, sagging movement equal. It is a classical problem. So this shows how they are doing the insulation. This is how they are lifting. You have the hooks here and hooks here, then you are lifting it. So there are two stages of design. One is for lifting, what is the reinforcement required. Actually it is not done like that. What they do is they do for the final stage of loading, find out what are the reinforcement provided at the bottom and check whether that reinforcement is sufficient during lifting. As you have seen in the initial slides, the sagging moment is very high. We have provided adequate reinforcement, so you can lift it from the end itself. And there are some reinforcements which are coming from the bottom itself. So these are the shear connectors between the precast and in situ construction. These are the reinforcements which will go into the pile gap, pile reinforcement gap to get integrity. And your top reinforcement where the hogging moment is come, that will be placed here and it will be continuous. So now they have placed. So whatever I explained earlier, you can see the pile cap here. This is the pedestal which is placed. Here the depth of the beam is smaller. Here it is the precast beam which is placed, and they have tied the reinforcement in the inside also, and the inside is hollow only here, but they have completed the reinforcement to reduce the time required to tie the reinforcement. This is the other beam that is placed. If this gap is not the same as maintained, since we are providing 150 mm pile cap, you have a bearing of at least minimum 100 millimeter. One side may be higher, 100 becomes 125, other side may become smaller, 100 will become 75. Minimum 75 may have to be provided. But this dimension is fixed. We do not change it for different tolerances, but we adjust by providing adequate pile cap width. So this is a calculation that is done for handling stresses. You calculate basically the bending moment. Normally for limit state design you multiply by the load factor to get the factored moment. You calculate what is known as RU, R that is mu by BD square. Mu is the bending moment, B is the width of the beam, and D is the precast thickness, effective depth. Then you get the percentage of steel using this formula and provide it accordingly. You calculate the number of bars and provide adequate bars like this. If you want to take the full width of the beam 1200, you need the shear reinforcement coming from the precast portion also into the in situ portion. You have to tie it together. You cannot assume the bond, interface bond between the precast and in situ construction. You need reinforcement anchorage into the precast and in situ, that is done by this shear stirrups. So this shows another view how they are placing these bars, especially the bars you can see here. This is for the sagging moment. Same calculation, you calculate R, use this formula to calculate the percentage of steel, then provide the percentage. You have to provide some minimum percentage. What is the minimum percentage required for column? Column is 0.4%, pile is 0.8, beam is 0.2%. This is the minimum reinforcement which you have to provide for the main bars, whatever your calculation shows. You get 8.56 bars means you can either provide 9 bars or 10 bars depending on what you want to decide. Don't provide 8.56 means 12 bars and all, provide very close to that. So there are two calculations, one is two stages I said, precast and in situ, or a temporary stage of construction and final operation. Another thing is you design the reinforcement by this, then you have to check for crack width, that is other type of design. So normally whatever reinforcement that is coming for stress level check, you have to increase at least 30 to 60% to check for crack width. I will explain that crack width later. This is the top reinforcement for hogging moment. Top reinforcement is coming for this case 0.55%, bottom is 0.4. So this R value, typically it is better to restrict about 3 or 3.5, don't keep anything more than that value, that is generally better. Don't increase the steel reinforcement more than 1%. Then you have to design for shear. There are certain things to be calculated. One is you calculate the nominal shear stress, that is the shear force divided by the width of the beam and depth of the beam, you get the shear stress. This is the shear stress what is coming here. Then you have to go to this table. This is in IS 456 table 19. What it shows is what is the percentage of steel provided, what is the grade of concrete, and what is the allowable shear stress. So allowable shear stress depends on not only the grade of concrete but also the percentage of steel. Don't say percentage of steel, percentage of tension steel, clear. Don't calculate the hogging moment percentage, sagging moment percentage and calculate. Calculate what is the percentage of tension steel, that is what is to be calculated. Suppose it is 1%, grade of concrete is M35, the allowable shear stress is 0.67. So that you have to calculate, then based on that for this particular case the percentage of steel is 0.56, for tau c max is 3.7. I'm sorry, this is different, that for any grade of concrete M35 the maximum shear stress that can be allowed is 3.7 newton per millimeter square. Suppose this shear stress what you are calculating is more than 3.7, you have to redesign the section. There are two stress what we are talking, one is the nominal shear stress, another is the maximum allowable shear stress for a particular grade of concrete. If the nominal shear stress is more than the maximum allowable shear, you have to either increase the grade of concrete or you have to revise the section. This is the permissible shear stress. So what you have to calculate is this VUS, that is the shear force to be taken by the reinforcement, is the shear force minus tau c. Tau c is coming from this table, tau c into b into d, and for this there is a formula to calculate the spacing for the provided diameter of the stirrup, and accordingly you can provide. We are providing 10 mm bars, 6 legs, there are 6 legs of reinforcement we are providing. You calculate the area of stirrups, and then you what you do is you calculate the spacing. It is coming 121.77. You provide a spacing less than this, 120 millimeters center to center. This also should not become very close. Generally the shear strip spacing is about 100 millimeters, not less than that. Then there is a class for minimum shear reinforcement. You check what is the minimum shear reinforcement, what is the spacing required. The spacing provided should be less than the minimum shear spacing what you are getting. So you have to do this check. So to summarize again, you have to check for shear, you have to calculate the nominal shear stress, this should be less than the maximum allowable shear stress. Then you have to calculate what is the shear to be taken by the stirrups. Then you find out the spacing, the spacing should be less than the spacing required for minimum shear reinforcement. That depends on the grade of steel and diameter of shear stirrups what you are providing. The spacing will be calculated using this formula. Then you have to provide side face reinforcement. Side face reinforcement is what is provided at this sites what you are showing. You cannot leave the skin like this, this is called as the side face reinforcement. The side face reinforcement also about some minimum percentage is there, that is 0.05 times the sectional area that you calculate. So this is 0.05% of B into D. You find out how many bars are required and provide the side face reinforcement. Then we have to check for crack width. Check for crack width is basically you are calculating what is the stress in steel, and accordingly you will be providing the reinforcements. I will go from the reverse side. So this is the formula for crack width. WCR is the crack width. There is a permissible crack width. It depends on the environmental condition. Generally the crack width is 0.1 millimeter, 0.2 millimeter and 0.3 millimeter. This is in the splash zone. This is in the submerged zone. This is in the mud zone. So the, suppose there is a pile here. This is your water level, this is your pit level. So this is your mud zone, this is your submerged zone. So the water goes up and down here during tidal, this is your, and above this is called as the beam. This you can call it as atmospheric zone. This also we may provide about 0.2 mm. So you have to calculate the crack width. This is a formula which you calculate the crack width, but generally the crack width depends on the stress in steel by Young's modulus. This gives the epsilon. Epsilon is the strain in steel. So the approximate formula for crack width, the old formula, this is I think 2.3 cover effective multiplied by epsilon st. So if you substitute cover in millimeter, the crack width will come in millimeter. This is an approximate formula. 2.3 is a coefficient, cover is the effective cover. Suppose it is 75 millimeters clear cover, effective may be 90 millimeters or 100 millimeters. Epsilon st is the stress in steel. So if you want to reduce the crack width, you have to reduce the stress in steel. You cannot reduce the Young's modulus, it is the same. But you want to reduce the crack width, do not reduce the cover. Okay, do not reduce the cover. If you want to reduce the crack width, cover is for durability, that is a different aspect. So this is a coefficient, but here in this particular case this formula is a little bit exhaustive. They here also they calculate this epsilon 1, that is fs by es into h minus x into d minus x. So this epsilon 1 is similar to epsilon st, that is fs by es into h minus x into d minus x. So in this epsilon st, what I have written is the stress in steel at this center of the reinforcement. Epsilon 1 is I think at the bottom surface, that is where that h minus x and d minus x is coming. Then there is a tensioning effect, and for that this percentage is reduced from the strain, that is called as epsilon m. And this formula, this ACR is the distance between, so it is using, I was using this one effective cover, what they are using is this distance is called as ACR, the maximum distance to the reinforcement bar from the surface. These are some modification which is done. This is wrong, I simply has made my student point 0.4 is never allowed. maybe he got this and he is putting it like this. It's never allowed, don't go by this, it should not be more than 0.3. Similarly, you can check for crack width at the top also. So once you place the beams precast, then you put some top reinforcements, then they have put this precast slabs. So we will discuss in the next class about the design of slab.